This lecture is simply entitled Review of the Hospice Team. Because as a hospice aide, you're part of an interdisciplinary team. A group of people, a group of trained people that their goal is basically providing care and comfort to the dying client and to their family. Hospice is not about cure. It's not about curative. It is all about, you know, controlling pain, controlling symptoms in a holistic manner, which is a whole manner. And when it comes to death and dying, a lot of times there's a multiple amount of changes and they start happening very rapidly. So because of these multiple changes, it takes not only just one person or one area caring for a person, but it takes a multiple number of people in different areas. So what this is basically called is collaboration or working together or the interdisciplinary team. One of the things that you'll be doing as a hospice aide is participating in the care planning. The care plan is like a map. If you've ever gone somewhere, you're going somewhere that you've never gone before, from your home to say Florida, a place in Florida, you're going to look at a map. And that's basically what the care plan is. It's a map. And it's a map from a problem or a need in the client's life. That's like point A on the map, and point B on the map is the goal. So in the care plan, it deals with problems and needs are listed in all areas, and then like I said, that's point A on the map, that would be your hometown. And the goal would be where you're driving to. You know, that's your goal. And in between there, how do we get from problem to goal? Interventions. So those are your major parts of a care plan. The problem or need, the goal of what we want to see resolution of the problem or need, and the interventions. The interventions are how we're going to get from problem to goal. What are we actually going to do? So the care plan team is like a brainstorming group of trying to discover the problems by assessment or the needs, and then to establish some goals and then write some interventions how we're basically going to get there. So it's done like through brainstorming, working together, problem solving. And the hospice aide is a very important member of this team. You know, if we had four people in a group and each of them was a very expert, they were a great artist, and they went out to paint a building, okay? And one stood on the north side, another on the east, another on the west, another on the south. They would paint an excellent picture of what they saw, but the person on the south would not see the features of the building that the person on the north saw. Same with the east and west. They would only see what they saw. So each of them would do a beautiful picture, but it wouldn't be a complete picture. Not until all four canvases were put together would we have a more complete picture of that building. Well, that's why the different people on the care plan team are there. Each of them has a picture of their area. But when they're put together with the different people on the care plan team, like the RN case manager, like the bereavement coordinator, like the chaplain or spiritual care coordinator, like the social worker, like even the volunteer, and of course your input as the hospice aide, then we have a full complete picture. And because a lot of people will look at something and sometimes The RN may look at something and the hospice aide looks at it a little bit differently and sees something a little bit differently. And a lot of time that input is really important. It's like I said, it's collaboration, it's working together. Now, the RN case manager or the case manager is going to be the one that is like the, call it like a team leader, okay? They are going to be directing the care. They are going to be the ones that are giving direction to the other peoples of the team about visiting, you know, and about areas that need basically to be addressed. The RN case manager is going to make their visits, and dependent on the need, dependent on what's going on, a lot of times it's like two to three times a week. And of course it fluctuates on need, of course it does, but on the average it's around 2 to 3 times a week. And the main things that they're going to be looking at is pain, you know, symptoms, you know, in the physical area. Yes, they're going to be looking for emotional areas or spiritual areas, issues too. But if they do assess some of those needs, they're probably going to be calling in the social worker if it's a psychological need or a social need, or the spiritual care coordinator if it's a spiritual need. So, but the RN case manager is going to be going in and basically assessing the physical needs of the client. Pain is going to be a big one. Symptoms, when we went through the signs of approaching death, looking at symptoms that are going to or could be causing the client distress. Neurological changes, cardiac, pulmonary, GI changes, GU changes, you know, different changes of the skin, different changes in the body systems, okay? They're going to be doing a teaching. A lot of teaching is done to the family, as the family is in the role of the caregiver. Because, you know, the hospice is not going to be there, you know, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Hospice does not take the place of the caregiver. They're a support to the caregiver. Now, a lot of hospices toward the very end may be there 24 hours, you know. And but as far as the weeks go by, you know, before they get to that point, you know, hospice is support to the caregiver and doesn't by any means come in and take the place of the family caregiver. So because of that, the RN case manager is going to be doing a lot of teaching to the family about pain medicines and how to give them, signs and symptoms and side effects of medications, and what to look for, when to give it, you know, how much to give, by what route to give. And a lot of times what they may call on you for is to observe or monitor the meds, you know, just basically make sure when you go on your visit, you know, like the family still has enough pills to get them by for several more days, or if it's a liquid, they still have enough liquid, you know, like if it's like Roxanol or something like that, that they still have enough to last them for several more days. And if they are running low, because here again, the RN may only come like once or twice a week, you may come 3 times a week. If the RN made their visit on Monday and you're making a Thursday or a Friday visit, and you're observing these meds and find out, oh my goodness, they're low, I don't think at the rate they're giving this Roxanol, like so much of it like every 2 hours, I don't think they're going to have enough to make it through the weekend. You don't want to run out, so you need to be calling that information to the RN case manager and let them know, so a refill can basically be ordered. So the RN case manager could be doing a lot of teaching plus a lot of assessing. Your role as going in, I'm sure one of the major things you'll be doing is probably bathing the residents, doing skin care, hair care, oral care, you know, a lot of that, relieving the family from those more heavier responsibilities. You may also be doing some environmental care, support for the family by laundry a little bit, dishes a little bit, maybe. Sometimes just being with the resident while the family needs to run out for a half hour and take care of some private business. The medical social worker is going to basically be emphasizing on the psychological and the social needs. Helping out with maybe finding equipment for the family that they need, but listening a lot, helping them as they go through the phases themselves of death and dying, denial, anger, bargaining, depression, acceptance, you know, helping them on an emotional level deal with, you know, what is happening to them because of their loved ones. Some time ago I started to write a book, and it has a kind of an abrupt title, but a lot of families, as they've kind of reviewed my book a little bit, and it's far from being published, you know, far from being done, but maybe all I've got done is the title. But I entitled it, it's short title is Hard Time Living. Well, its more extended title is I'm Having a Hard Time Living While You're Dying. And like I said, it's kind of an abrupt title, but every hospice family that I've shared this with said that's exactly how I thought. I was having a hard time coping. I was a hard time continuing on with my life, my duties, my responsibility. I was having a hard time living while mom or dad or whoever was basically dying because of all the changes that I had to do to basically be with them. So that's the social worker. That's the medical social worker. Helping people, the family, deal with those issues, having a hard time living while they are caring for someone who's basically dying. The spiritual care coordinator, of course, is going to be there for the spiritual needs. You know, they don't preach, they don't take up an offering or stuff like that, you know, but they're there to help the person on this journey. Because a lot of times, you know, people will have questions. They will have fears, you know, coming to the end of their life. And what's going to happen to my family? What's going to happen to me? Different spiritual needs that people will have when they're faced with that reality. So there's the spiritual care counselor, the chaplain, whatever you prefer to call them, is basically there to help them with that. In hospice, there are volunteers. Every hospice has a list of volunteers, and these are folks that just go into the house. They don't get paid, they volunteer their time, but they go into the home environment, they go into the house, and they just are a friend. They're a companion, they're a helper, and they support the hospice team by providing a very valuable service to the client and to their family. Different volunteers that we've had, that I've seen in our hospice, have done everything from taking a child fishing, you know, a young child, to a movie. We've had different volunteers that have gone into the house and have just stayed with the client while the primary caregiver maybe went to the beauty shop if it was a lady, or went out and paid some bills. Different volunteers have gone in and read and sang to folks. We even had a situation where a couple of our volunteers repaired a leaky roof. There is no limit to what a volunteer can basically do. As they're offering support, you know, support and coming into the house, coming into the family, coming into the situation, and basically providing for a need that is not, you know, needs to basically be met. And like I said, volunteers are invaluable. Another team member of the hospice team is the bereavement coordinator. The majority of the bereavement coordinator's job is after the death. They may go meet the family and just introduce themselves, but they come into the picture at the point of death, going to visitation, going to the funeral. And what's required by Medicare, Medicaid, and a lot of insurance companies is a 13-month follow-up. And this is the job of the bereavement coordinator. The bereavement coordinator will basically assess who was the primary caregiver. Like in the case of a husband had cancer, well, the wife would naturally be, you know. And for 13 months minimum, they keep in contact with that individual through phone calls, letters, group meetings, and of course, personal visits. Because a lot of times after death, it can do, because of the loss and grieving process, a lot of physical changes, a lot of emotional changes, a lot of different situations. The stress of a loss, you know, could cause even a cardiac event, you know, in the caregiver, is that they're missing the person so much. And so the bereavement coordinator helps the primary caregiver now on their journey, you know, helping them through the separation, not ever trying to tell the person to forget them, to get over them. Because do you ever? Of course not, you know. Does the pain sometimes lessen? Well, hopefully it does, you know. But the bereavement coordinator is a friend that sticks with, and like I said, if it's a lot of caregivers, they'll pick out who they believe are the primary one or two or three or whatever, and then, you know, go through this journey with them for at least 13 months through, like I said, the different forms of contacting, and having group meetings where they can come in and like a discussion time with other people that have suffered loss and hear their story and share their story of healing and recovery. And just gradually kind of, you know, because they've been in a time of just serving and helping their loved one, and now with the loved one gone on, now the time returns to them too, and just helping them to transition from that. So the bereavement coordinator is going to be helping those folks. So in the hospice team, like I said, you've got your RN, case manager, you've got yourself as a hospice aide, you've got medical social workers, you've got spiritual care coordinators, you've got volunteers, you've got bereavement coordinators. And of course the physician, you know, is in the team also. The most important team member, the client themselves. The second most important team member, the family. All are working together, you know, for again trying to make the best day possible for this person that we possibly could do. So that ends this lecture on the hospice team. Thank you.